In order to successfully realize architectural concepts, the architect has to negotiate ideas on paper through technical design and the planning process. Construction and the delivery of the physical building. In order to achieve this, the project has to be procured through established processes with the aim to achieve the objectives of delivery on time, within budget, and to a high quality. It is critical that as students you develop into professional deliverers of buildings, and inevitably an understanding of procurement processes and models is essential for a successful realization of a project. And a lot of you are construction management students, so that's even much more crucial for you guys. Today's speaker, Professor Davis, recently joined the University of Newcastle as Chair of Construction Management. John Holland and Len Lee's PATH sponsors the chair in collaboration with the University of Newcastle. He is recognized as a national authority on integrated procurement based on 20 years industry experience. Collaborative research and consultancy expertise with firms in Perth, Western Australia. Apart from research into contemporary construction procurement, he actively researches teaching, learning in the discipline and was presented a Curtin University Excellence and Innovation in Teaching Award. Today, he will discuss the fundamental behaviors that underpin successful procurement and will draw on his expertise in the industry, an extensive postdoctoral research in procurement, and most particularly alternative and integrated delivery approaches. Today's talk is titled Relationship Procurement, Adding Value Through Relationship Development and Maintenance. Please all welcome Peter Davis.
Thank you for that introduction, Nina. I hope you can hear me. A little introductory slide, as Nina suggested. My position here as Professor of Construction Management is partly sponsored by Lendlease and John Holland. I've got quite a long background, particularly with John Holland in Perth, so I was very pleased to accept the position on the basis of their assistance, and I work quite regularly with the local John Holland team up here. So it's a good relationship. So as Nina suggested, today I'm putting a presentation together which talks about relationship development. Mainly my research is around relationship development and maintenance. And so I put a couple of words up there about what drives the situation. So we're going to have a look at a little bit of a history to some degree about construction. And then I'll go on to talk about some aspects of my research, which hopefully will provide some success to the team. And as I said, it's supported by Lendlease and John Holland. So here's a picture that I captured off our website, the university website. Many of you will be aware of the new space building that the University of Newcastle will be developing. I understand right now that they're doing the preliminary groundworks, which is filling up all the mine workings. And so there's pretty extensive work done underground, which is pretty new to me, because in WA we don't have soil as such, we just have sand, and we don't have holes in it because it collapses. So the concept of filling large voids that were constructed up to 100 years ago is quite intriguing for me. But it does add a different dimension to the construction process. The important point about that picture, it's not really the red arrows that point here, there and everywhere. Not one of them points towards my house anyway. But the point is that that is a piece of social infrastructure. So much of my research revolves around either social or economic infrastructure. And my effort is to instill productivity into that. So there's a great deal of work currently in that space, and this is just one typical building. So for 95 million, this is what you get. So it's pretty expensive. Just as an aside, when I was your age, you could have probably got that building for 2 million. So it shows how long I've been kicking around, and I think the next slide gives you a little bit about me. So that's my transition from right to left, Curtin University, the floor plan. I thought it would interest the architects and the construction managers alike. That's a floor plan of the building where I used to occupy, and at the front view, and then down the bottom, a more familiar picture that you'd be aware of, obviously the Red Square. And so you can see my background, a construction manager, QS, by trade if you like, 20 years experience, then 20 years in a university. I've done a master's in project management at Curtin, which was a coursework master's, and I've got a PhD in finance and economics from RMIT. So my supervisor, Professor Derek Walker, probably commend him to you for further reading if you're interested in anything that I actually say this afternoon about the relationships. So let's step back, and what has been on researchers in my area's mind for a long period of time have been several reports that I've identified above which sort of characterise the construction industry. And these are screenshots from the actual documents that you can see there. So up on the top, you've got the Banwell report, which was around 1967, so none of you would have been even born then. And indeed, I wasn't actually that old in 1967, but I certainly don't recall the report coming out. But constructing the team I do, and then rethinking construction, I do remember that. The point I'm making is that you probably know that construction is typically adversarial, as I've suggested there. Those reports have endeavoured to sort out the problems to some degree. Several years ago, I was fortunate enough to go to a conference in the UK. It was run by the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, which is a kindred institution to the Australian Institute of Quantity Surveyors. A room not dissimilar to this, and I recall the keynote speaker quite well. His name was Tony. I've forgotten his last name, so I remember quite well. I'll remember it in a second. So this guy was a lawyer. And he wrote, Tony Bingham, he wrote a paper in a journal every month. So it's really a magazine about building and building issues. Every month he wrote a light-hearted but serious law article. And so I was very keen to see this guy. It was probably 20 years since I'd been reading his articles. Big auditorium, lots of people there, all in their suits, all RACS qualified people, quantity surveyors and construction managers. Tony Bingham comes out onto the stage and stands there and says, "Whatever you do, just keep doing it." He said, "My wife has a very nice car and she has an apartment on the south of France. My offices are in Chelsea, near my flat, and I have a very good life." And it took a few moments before the audience actually got the gist of what he was saying, because what he was saying is what I've shown you up here. It's 1967, 1990, 1994, and beyond, more recently, and in between. There have been reports after reports after reports on what problems there are associated with our industry. And it is our industry, whether you're a construction manager or an architect. These are the problems that have been vexing the minds of many experts for years and years and years. So that I found was a very intriguing presentation, because what he was saying, keep on doing it, because I'm making a fortune. All the time, the arguments are there, the disputes are there, I'm making quite a bit of money and I'm quite happy. You can see, you put it into context, the Australian construction industry represents a large proportion of gross domestic product. It also represents a large portion of the state domestic product. It's a big, big industry. Houses, offices, roads and bridges. I've spoken about economic and I've spoken about social infrastructure and the differences between the two. But it's important to know that it's a big industry. So there we are, have a characteristic of it. So we're going to talk about procurement in a general context, and then I'm going to move through to talk about some of my research associated with it. Much of what I'm presenting here today has come from research that I've been involved with, or close associates of mine who have been researching in this space. So there's three definitions in the blue boxes of procurement, and you can see that in simple terms, it could be the transactions between a buyer and a seller. The framework within which construction is brought about, acquired, or obtained. So this is the procurement, and we'll see that there are many derivatives and alternatives to it. So simply speaking, down the bottom you can see I've suggested that it's a group brought together to conceptualise, develop and operationalise the project. So it is the temporary team, the temporary organisation that comes together to deliver that project from go to woe. And nowadays, in this decade, we're finding that that team is coming together much earlier and remaining together for a much longer period of time. However, it does disappear at some point in time, and it's interesting to see how that may change over time. So it's complex, and that's what the issue is. The interaction, the fact that it's diverse. A couple of weeks ago, I went to a workshop in Perth on mega projects, where we wrapped our brains about the difference between a project and how that becomes a mega project. Like all academics, we felt we should put a figure to it. We came up with a couple of $1 billion. So anything above a couple of $1 billion, which is staggering amounts of money, we could classify as a mega project. Makes me think back to my past. As I said, that building that cost $95 million today, and you don't get much for anything less than $100 million. In my day, you probably got that for $1 or $2 million, in the 70s when I started working in about the 80s. So things have changed significantly. Some of you may have seen the Austin Powers films, where there was a section in there where he went back in time to the 60s, and that was the premise of the film. If you haven't watched it, you ought to watch it, it's quite amusing. And there was a scene in there where he was blackmailing somebody or an organisation, and because he'd gone back in time, he said, right, let's blackmail them, let's ask them for $10 billion. And of course they all started laughing because nobody had even imagined $10 billion, let alone $10 million. It wasn't money that people thought about. So the story went on, and he went forward in time, back to probably 2010 or whenever the film came out. And then he revised his bid for the cost. He said, let's blackmail them. We'll ask them for $2 million. And of course that was a loose challenge to all the people around the table, and again they laughed. But you put that into context, you can see how the figures are changing. And in your working career, you'll find that the figures will change significantly over time. So it won't be long before you're involved in what I suggest are mega projects. So in procurement, what are the important issues? And this slide shows what is often referred to as an iron triangle, which identifies cost, time and quality. The point being that in your procurement selection, and often architects are involved in this, generally construction contractors get involved in this too in some procurement models, you have to decide out of those high-level procurement objectives, those high-level objectives, which are the important ones. Because as you can see, you move the dollar sign around, and you can change the emphasis. So for example, if time is up the top there and quality is here, a move toward time could be something like an Olympic Games. You can't change the date when the Olympics starts, so you have to focus on the time. In an Olympics, there's a great deal of community pride, national pride involved, so you want it to be a quality type of project. So you can see by moving that dollar symbol around, you can review the types of projects. Now I suggested they're high level objectives. There are many objectives that you might want to achieve. They might be environmental, sustainability for example. They may revolve around cost. They may revolve about time. There may be other ones that community engagement for example may be one of the high level issues that you're pursuing, the objectives. So those are the high-level objectives, and there are several others, and we'll look at those to some degree. So where does procurement fit? And in this slide, I've shown you the life cycle of a project. And what you can see, as I've identified, are the general aspects of the procurement life cycle. So you can see there's the concept with a question mark, because the idea is there. Do we need a new build? Are we going to refurbish an existing building? How are we going to meet the needs of the person that we're, or the organisation that we're dealing with? So you have the concept, the question. You get involved with the design. Nowadays that may be, well, would often be done in CAD, it might be a building information modelling type of exercise, but certainly you need to create the design, the documentation. So that's the second phase. The implementation phase, the doing phase from a construction perspective, is where you build the thing. So if you go back to the new space project, you would find that they're pretty much in the design phase at the moment. There's some work going on site, but the design of the actual project is going on. Then you move to the close phase, which I've identified there. Nowadays, we're finding that procurement is moving much more into a whole life of the project. So that's why in this slide, I've identified that green area, which is extended somewhat, in the operation and maintenance phase. So if you think about a public-private partnership, for example, and there are many examples around the country of that now. I know that the Mater Hospital, if I pronounce that correctly, here in Newcastle, is an example of a public-private partnership. Probably one of the first in Australia. In my experience, there's only been one PPP type of project in WA, and that was a building that was the Law Courts, and that was built by Brookfield Multiplex when there was still Multiplex. There are a number of PPP projects around, and internationally, that type of procurement has been growing significantly. And I'll talk about that later. So I've identified in that phase, the operation and maintenance goes on. And so my strong belief is that construction companies will become much more involved in the product of the building in its whole life than they have in the recent past. And that's certainly something worth investigating. So, a procurement continuum. Now, this really identifies the myriad alternatives that you can have in procurement. So I've identified two at the poles. So here on the left, you can, on the right, we look at the right, we've got a tender lowest price. So design, bid, build type of procurement. And on that, you can see that it's very high, as I describe it, from a transactional perspective. It's a one-off type of thing. It's very transactional, very arm's length, and in my view, there's not much opportunity to build relationships within that. However, on the other end of the continuum, and bear in mind, along that line there, there are any number of different types of procurement that we could consider. And they move from very low in relationship orientation in blue, because blue's good and grey's not so good. So in blue, you can see that you get to the point where you can have an integrated project delivery or an alliance type of project, or indeed, as I've referred to before, a PPP type of project at that end of the continuum. Within that, you've got design and construct, you've got management contracting, all different terms used for different types of procurement. There are many, many different models. And when I first started getting involved in construction, I found it very difficult to keep track of the acronyms and the process involved. You don't need to worry yourself too much about that, because you'll learn it, and you'll learn the particular ones that you're involved with in your construction time. The important thing to think about is they are simply an organisational structure. An organisational structure utilised to deliver the project in the way that you, the architect, the builder, the client, the specialist consultants would choose to deliver it in. Bear in mind that the different procurement options have different advantages and different disadvantages. They carry different levels of risk, and they carry different levels of reward for different members of the team or different organisations within that virtual team that delivers that project. So I've highlighted a few there, and you can see that we've got four or five separate, and I've put them from right to left, as you can see on the bottom bullet point.
Like all academic things, they're sort of categorised, so you can see up the top there, we have separated, which is traditional, design, bid, build, so it's a separate process where the organisations are separate from one another, they don't come together very early on, there are some problems associated with that, and we'll talk about those later. Through integrated, an example I've used already is a design and construct, often used nowadays. Through collaborative relationship, which relational, which I'm interested in and research extensively, as do other colleagues in my discipline or in your discipline if you're in construction. So you can see that the collaborative is at this end and the design, bid, build would be at that end. Now research tells us that in some instances you can look at a 5% reduction in the price of a, or the delivery cost, the target outturn cost, of a project if you utilise the right procurement. So research says that if you, over time, using all different alternative procurement methods, the general figure you can look at is 5%. Of course, that may increase significantly, it may be slightly less. So it is important and it's worthwhile. So going back to my initial slide, when you think about productivity, you think about the gross national product, you think about the affordability of infrastructure, you think about billion-dollar mega projects, it can make an enormous difference to the outcome from a societal basis and from an organisational perspective. So just to give you a little bit of a pointer there, on the left you can see the relationship, still in the blue, so the relationship style is in the blue, and on the right there you can see the transactional. So you can see a couple of positives up the top there, and I'll just consider a couple. Design resolved before tender in the transactional. So because the design is resolved before you go out to tender, there's really no opportunity to vary things without enormous cost. So if the architect, using their best endeavours, have designed the project, it goes to the building team, and they say, oh, well, you could have done this, you could have done that. There could be some aspects of buildability involved in it. There's no way of dealing with that without additional cost. Moving across to the other side, you're looking at developing the scope. Again, developing the key performance indicators and the key results areas together. So you can see, forgetting about the process of getting there, my view is that the blue side provides much better outcomes in the whole project life cycle than the grey side, if for no other reason than you're integrating the team, that you're looking at design elements. There are many other facets that I'll talk about. The design's important, but take into account the builder's experience into the process and you can get much better outcomes. So there's one aspect that's worth considering. And I've jotted down the little drawing there, so you can keep that in mind. This one, I mentioned the myriad of procurement options. There they are. This was a bit of research that I did back some time ago for the Building Environment Institute Commission or something like that, a big multinational organisation with a commission through the Construction Research Council, Construction Innovation, and we developed that. So in a small snapshot of people surveyed, you can see that at this point in time, alliance and public-private partnerships were on the increase. The colours, I think, came out too well, actually. They're on the increase. Other ones, and down here you can see lump sum, traditional lump sum, design, bid, build, is clearly on the decrease. But the important point of that slide is not necessarily a small sample, but the myriad of examples of procurement model that you can have. And so, as I said before, don't worry too much about those issues. The important thing is to know that there are a great deal and it's really an organisational delivery process. So, selecting the right procurement model, experience, expert advice, and procurement toolkits. So I put the logo of the AIB up there because I think somebody with that qualification would be able to give you
as a client, whether you're an architect client, whether you're a builder client, or whether you're a public client or a private client, people from professional disciplines can do that. So that would be well sought. And then the other article I've shown there is a front page of a mini guide to procurement, which I was involved with some time ago. And in that example, we looked at, in the slide before, all the myriad of different types of procurement method that were available and endeavoured to design a toolkit that would allow good selection to take place. So it was designed to say, here are the key integrated, packaged, separated types of procurement. These are their benefits. These are their shortcomings. If you're looking to deliver a project of this nature, then this one might be the best to select. It also allowed you to make your choice outside of that. So you could look at the selection, the preferred selection. The toolkit allowed for an iterative recycling of information process. So projects that were finished, there would be feedback, there would be closing the loop into the document, into the software that would allow the selection process to be upgraded to show case studies and examples where betterment had incurred. So what are the trends? I mean, that's a fairly fast-moving piece. I think it's fair to say that public-private partnerships seem to be overtaking alliance-type procurement. Contractors, in my view, and from my experience, tend to like the opportunity to work in alliance-type of projects. However, some clients and consultants that advise clients tend to feel that an alliance-type of procurement model may benefit the contractor in terms of profitability. So they think that it perhaps doesn't allow, in their terms, for value for money. I tend to doubt that, and I still believe quite strongly that a single turnout cost alliance is better than a PPP type of project. But there, as you can see, as I've shown you in the slide, there are many variables, so it's a difficult decision to come to. So there's a few trends up there on the board that you can see. Just recently, the Productivity Commission provided a report to industry and others, and a couple of points that I picked up. It's a very big document. It's over 300 pages. I thought I was getting somewhere as I read through it, but then I realised I'd only got to about page 50 or 60, and that was the end of the introduction. It's a massive document. You know, I was reading it on screen, and it wasn't until I looked at the sliding cursor down the right-hand side and realised that it hadn't actually moved. I realised I was nowhere near through the 300 pages. But I did get through the introduction, and it's a worthy document to read. But what it does say is, as you can see there, inadequate procurement selection leads to poor value for money. And that's the key, is how to obtain value for money for your client. And what they're saying is that poor selection lets you down. It also talks about scope to improve the cost of tendering. Now, I've kept very close relationships with my colleagues in industry throughout my academic career, and I know from experience, as you saw, I've had 20 years experience prior to coming into university life, and I know that the cost of tendering is extortionately expensive. I think on a later slide, you'll see that it represents something close to, on average, again, 2% of the contract sum of a building. So they are staggering figures. Now, one of the things that I'm sort of wrapping my head around is trying to reduce the cost of that tendering and create value for money in that tendering process. One of the answers, I believe, is to integrate the team and to drive the costs down at the earliest opportunity. So as I've said before, if the documents are all put together and complete, and the building starts, goes out to tender in a design bid build, there is very little opportunity to drive down costs. The tendering costs have already been put in place. But if you bring the people together, you bring those teams together, and you start thinking about what you're building, you start thinking about innovation and
I believe quite strongly that when some people say that there really isn't very much innovation in construction, that buildings are buildings are buildings, and they have been that for many, many years, I think they're wrong, because I believe in the tendering process, that is where the individual builders, the contractors, and with the architects and the other consultants, that's where the innovation takes place. But take, for example, any tender for any builder. The only opportunity that builder has to better the price of all their competition is to think about something that's different, some way that they can do it differently that the other contractors haven't thought about. I've tended on many projects in my career. I used to do estimating for a good number of years when work was tight. And I've lost jobs for just several tens of thousand dollars. On one instance, I recall the only reason that my company lost the tender by a few thousand dollars was the other company that beat us, they had utilised a mobile crane. We decided to use a static crane, and the difference in cost of the downturn of that crane, which added the cost to our tender, to a mobile crane, made the absolute difference. Was that innovation? I think it was. It was something we hadn't thought of, but I certainly thought about it after I found that snippet of information out. So it's important to understand that it's difficult to win tenders, they cost a lot of money, and in my view, it's innovation that matters. Here's a picture of a project, and there's a 2% tender price. It's an average. That's a big project, $2 billion. It's the Fiona Stanley Hospital in Perth, WA, built by Brookfield Multiplex. Suffice to say, it was a recession-busting project. It's just finished now. Like all good hospitals, it will remain empty for another year while they get the thing up and running and everybody learns how to use it. Aside from that point, you could argue that it was a recession-busting project. I was involved with John Holland, who were the unsuccessful tenderer on that project, and I worked with them to try and build what were known at the time, through my research, as capability maturity models. The idea, in an environment where most things had gone pear-shaped through the global financial crisis, with a recession-busting type project, you have the opportunity to lift the game of construction through the specialist contractors, through the head contractors, through a recession-busting project like that. Turned out that the client, public client, were really focused on cost. That was where they saw value for money. They didn't necessarily see it in some of the intangible aspects that I believed were important. So good procurement and contract strategy. So a procurement method, standalone, put it with a standard form of contract or the contract, and you've got the contract strategy. Reduce the cost of tendering, reduce project overruns, and mitigate error. So let's have a look at each one of those. I've gone through them sequentially so we can have a look. And here you see again, I've got the delivery model here. I've told you about the cost of tendering. In this project that we have here in Newcastle, they're tending to follow this route: the expression of interest, pre-qualification, and then invitation. So they've gone down from 5 to 3 to 1 in that tendering process. And they're integrating the design team. So they're really, I believe, following good practice. So the tender is measured against the statement of work, that's short for, and they're built collaboratively. So that's where the cost of the tendering comes from. I've sort of explained that before. Project overruns. Interestingly, that less than half of the projects that we build in Australia are delivered on time. That's amazing, isn't it? And that's been year on year on year on year. There's not many projects that are delivered on time. I have to say that a good deal of my projects that I ran while I was here in WA and in the UK, they didn't always finish on time, so I can't put my hand up for the betterment of that. As I've said before, contractor involvement improves that opportunity to shorten down time. So these are three reasons, really, why we should be looking at in my view, integrating the project team. So the likelihood of changes is reduced. There's a typical time plan for those of you who haven't seen one before. Delay and disruption. A few years back, I got involved, as I mentioned, with the CRC. There was this document that came out of it on this delay and disruption, and there were a number of factors that we found in the research that were problematic. Clearly, scope change, documentation are issues that needed to be fine-tuned. Mistakes and errors were clearly part of that. And I'm not pointing any fingers at anybody, because I know there are reasons why design documentation errors take place. Often it's because the consultants, the specialist consultants that we might use, we tell them that they've only got a limited amount of time. We automatically focus them down to the time imperative. We don't look for best practice. We look for a cost value for money solution. And that can lead to errors. That can lead to mistakes. Those errors and mistakes in this research that I've highlighted here lead to what we described as, my colleague and myself, pathogenetic errors. So these are latent errors that happened sometime in the past. It may be that you're in a meeting room working out some design details, nutting out a problem, a phone rings, you walk out of the office, you come back, the meeting's proceeded. Had you been there, you may have pointed out that that could cause problems down the track. The fact that you weren't, because of time pressure, because you looked at the phone, you took that call, because you were under pressure on another job, or there were pressures on a number of jobs, you left the room, and that's where that small seed of error started. That small seed of error, through the project lifecycle that we've seen in earlier slides, gradually grows and grows and grows, to the point that you're pouring the slab, that you're installing the curtain walling, or you're putting in some HVAC services, and you suddenly realise that's not going to go there. And that's where the mistake could have happened conceivably way, way down the track, 5 years earlier in a design development meeting where a phone call was taken. Had it not been taken, things may have been different. So that pathogens is important. So I don't know whether you've seen that film Sliding Doors, but there's another example of how two different routes give two different alternatives. I seem to be in a film sort of mindset this afternoon. So, mitigating error. Again, I'll use a case study from Perth. This is the new project, Perth Arena. You can see that it cost a great deal of money in the outset, $168 million. They thought they'd get it for. Well, did they? No, they didn't. It cost $548 million. This is all on the public record, incidentally, the problems that were associated with it, because they were so concerned, the state government in WA, that they got the Auditor General in to have a look at the project. And the Department of Treasury and Finance, the head of whom I know very well and gave a presentation at Mega Projects just 2 weeks ago, was fairly open about these issues that have been problematic. There was no procurement analysis. The design was incomplete. There was poor governance. So these are the things that caused those errors. There were major scope changes. So, for example, an external car park was put beneath the building after the project had started. So huge changes. And you can see that the cost involved there, 168 to 548 million, great deal of money. So let's have a look at building the team. And this is some of my more recent research. I'll just flick through to where I am. So we've seen a few problems have appeared over time. They haven't gone away. That guy Tony Bingham, who made us all laugh when he came into the auditorium in the UK, set out the problem. So what are the answers? The answers, I believe, come down to building relationships. So there are a number of slides here covering two projects that I was involved with over a number of years. One of them was, well, what is the association between relationship marketing, a great body of knowledge, and relationships within the construction team? Before coming to Australia, I lived in the Channel Islands, which are a small group of islands. Some of you may know where they are. Google them. Quite a small group. Jersey is probably not much bigger than this room, in fact, but has about 80,000 people on it. But I learned very quickly through working there for 10 years that you can't afford to let relationships go, that that's an important aspect in what we do. I also realised that it's not something that I felt we did very well in construction. However, my research sort of countered that to some degree, as you can see from, as you will see from some of the slides I'm going to show you. So on the left there, you've got a relationship approach, and you can see there's a focus on client retention, there's a focus on commitment, there's a focus on quality. And then down on the right hand side here, you can see a commentary on what it is about. The BIM aspects that I've added in more recent times. So you can see that to build a relationship approach, there are several attributes that you should focus on. My question in this bit of research was, well, do construction people actually review that sort of research? Two or three important ones, commitment and trust, they were found to be important. So commitment, the long-term orientation. So as I said before, contractors are moving from looking at the process of building a building much more to what's the product about. PPPs, build, own, operate, transfer, long-term 30-year project life cycles. So gone are the days when we used to look at a 3-year project, build it, walk away, let somebody else worry about it, apartment defects, liability, and that sort of thing. Nowadays, we're looking at very much longer projects. So the process of building the project is part of it, but the actual operation and maintenance is a further point that we need to consider. Oops. Another one is trust. Trust is one of the fundamental issues that needs to be addressed in construction. I mentioned earlier that recently alliances are falling out of favour. Really, the only reason they're falling out of favour is because clients have been talking with consultants and others, and they decided that they don't trust the contractor in developing a target outcome cost that's realistic. So if, for example, you develop a $5 million target outcome cost for a particular project, let's say $500 million, if that's an inflated price at the time of preparation, it could easily be bettered. So the consultants and the clients are worried that if the contractor, in association with naive clients, build a target outturn cost that's inflated, then of course you're going to beat that in terms of cost. That's one of their particular worries. And so that's why trust is important. The third aspect there was satisfaction. So there I reviewed, there were 1,000 people potentially that I got results from in this piece of research, and so I'll run through some of the actual findings as we go through. So upstream relationships. So these are the relationships. If I'm the contractor and you're the client, the upstream relationship is from me to that client. And what you can see here, I did a factor analysis of all of those findings. And what you can see is that the relationship product here, it actually doesn't come out that strong. It's difficult to follow, but I'll point them out. There's the relationship ones. Might have to change this slide. And in the client ones, you can see the relationship ones here, and in the design. So the three teams, the three aspects of the team, client, contractor, and design, you can see that the contractor and the design team were all similar in which of those variables they clustered together. And it turns out that they're quite product focused. Now, product focus, as I mentioned before, is a whole life. It's a long-term thing. It indicates that they're interested in relationships, whereas the process is the short-term project, if you like. The start, project life cycle, the build and hand, the build and handover
of the project life cycle. So you can see that it turns out that the contractors and the designer, to some degree, the clients, are interested in the product of the delivery over these issues. And you can see these are quite straightforward things. So, for example, schedule reductions upstream is related to the process. Well, of course it is, because that's part of the building of the building. But what this does show, and I'll flip through a couple more slides with the downstream, and I'll colour these in for the next time I do this, so apologies for that. The downstream ones, you can see how they've clustered those. Again, they sort of clustered around the relationship marketing ones in the contractor and design. Some in the client are less defined, difficult to explain, but it revolves around quality. And then if we look at the outcomes from that, you can see that there were no significant differences in the sample, and they were very interested around commitment and trust, and two or three points around those: confidential information sharing or willingness to customise. So you can customise up front in the project, but you can't customise through the life of the project without it being a variation and costly. The other thing, confidential information sharing is important because it is a key indicator of trust. If you're going to give some sort of confidential information to a third party, you want to know that you can trust them. It's as simple as that. You're not going to give bank account numbers to somebody you don't trust. And it's an indicator of trust. You can see on this slide where the key indicators of satisfaction lie. So these were the things that I found in my research were the important things on satisfaction. The whole group that I surveyed, all that 900 people, organisations rather, they identified rank in upstream, they identified interactive, relationship, communicative. They identified the second one as matching previous favourable experience. They were interested in fairly intangible issues associated with project selection. And then downstream, understanding problems, needs and interests. So they wanted to know that people were interested in solving problems for them. An issue like that. Second on the list was matching favourable experience. So they didn't match up. But some interesting results there. So what that shows me is that the construction organisation has a propensity toward trust and relationships. They're keen to build with one another. So why wouldn't we do alliance projects is simply my question, because it's fairly, well, with a sample of 900 across the country, I think it's quite compelling evidence. So once we've established that relationship, we need to build those. This image is one of the National Museum. Some of you may have been there. Intriguing building, but it was one of the early alliance projects that were built in this country. And my colleague, who was my supervisor when I did my PhD, he did an extensive study on this project, and it was shown to be exemplary in terms of process and product through the short-term project, but also through the long-term as well. So what's the relationship development process? There are several authors that I highlighted there, and like all academics, we drive them into phases 1, 2, and 3. Those are the three phases that I identified. And you can see on this model, which is my conceptual relationship development model, I've highlighted what happens in each one of those phases. So you've got an assessment phase, a committed phase, and an enduring phase. And in actual fact, my research at the moment, I'm going to drill down in each one of those phases and really look at the behaviours in a lot more depth. I'm looking at an issue called psychological contracts, which is what is commonly referred to as the personal deal. And the personal deal is the relationship that you would have in your mind with your employer. It's not the piece of information that's written down on your contract of employment, but it's actually what you believe you do for a living on a daily basis. An interesting concept, and it's worthwhile investigating in this. So in this one, it was a qualitative piece of work before I did a semi-structured survey, and I had 900. In this, I just interviewed 49 people. Took quite a long time, and you can see there where they came from. That's the sample, quite diverse. Good deal of them in WA, because I couldn't afford the airfare to get over here. Still can't. But what I identified were three interrelated themes. So the individual relationships, the engendered trust, and the organisational development. All three of those came out very strongly in that qualitative piece of work. So in developing that three-stage model from the literature, the respondents felt a little bit uncomfortable with that first part of the process. They were unfamiliar with it, as I had identified up there. It caused them some hesitation. But it did show that they were prepared to do it, although the feedback showed that they were prepared to do it. And as I'd found in my earlier research, there was a preparedness to trust. So the teams that came together, they came in with an open mind and they were prepared to trust one another. They believed that they were going into a committed, trusting environment. And of course, with that belief, if there were any problems, if it wasn't reciprocated to some degree, it could have caused problems. So trust builds commitment. Commitment builds trust. So it's that rolling snowball of building that's important. And as I said before, the trust should be reciprocated. In the organisational development, and I'll show you some models in a second or two, there were lots of issues associated with the business as usual type of development that were, if you like, life balance skills. And I don't say work-life balance, because I think work is part of life. So it's more life balance skills and life balance issues. So you can see on the slide, they were interested in skills and training. And in these projects, they actually sent those skills out in terms of, and those abilities, through public lectures. So they were very involved in working with that team and the community that supported that team, because they understood that if the people that were working in their offices on a daily basis were much more comfortable in what they did, because they were relaxed and they were highly charged and motivated, there was every likelihood that they would perform better. The better way that they could see was to support their partners, as simple as that. They provided quite diverse support to the communities, not just for the people operating in the project, but for the people outside the project. So this was the revised one, and you can see that the difference really is that I've identified those aspects of individual relationships, the trust, and the organisational development buried within that delivery model. And that's quite important. Without that, it doesn't work. So there's a couple of, that was, I did that research. More recently, you can see that there's a supporting model here by a couple of colleagues who I know very well, and they've delivered something which I believe is not dissimilar. In as much as you can see down the bottom bubble, they've got a platform of foundational facilities. So that is the type of facilities that you operate from, the processes that I've spoken around. So managing the process, managing the way things are done is important. Extremely important on the left-hand side are the behavioural factors. How you bring the team together, as I said before, how you get those people to coalesce into an operating integral team. This other model, Ibrahim, you can see that a large portion of the behaviours and other things are accounted in the team leadership, the trust and respect, and the focus on the key result areas and objectives. So that accounts for a good deal of the model in terms of what's important. So those two models, I believe, support and build on my model to some degree. So all in all, there isn't really a silver bullet, so I have no answer for you. I think the important things are to give careful thought to the selection process. And over my working life, I've found that, you know, projects that seem to come together quite well can fall apart, seemingly no good reason. But I do think that the reason, as I've put on the last bullet point there, is that it's the lack of relationships. There's a little bit of bibliography. I don't know whether this will go up on a web page for you to review. Interesting quote. I've just got into putting up quotes lately. I've spotted other academics do it, and they're always quite light-hearted. But I think that one's fairly good. We shape our buildings, thereafter they shape us. And I think that's very true. And I think it's true for architects, and I think it's true for construction management teams, because in shaping our buildings, we create the teams that shape the buildings, and those buildings not only shape us in their long-term time, but they shape us in the creation of them. So I think that's important.